welcome and thanks for coming, of course, as first. I'm going to introduce myself. I'm Tim Meijer. This is my first workshop and lecture, both, so I'm sorry for my bad English, for any mistakes I make or anything else. And if you get any questions, just ask them and I'm glad to answer them. Let's first tell us what we're going to do today. First going to introduce myself, how I got into photography and where I am now. I'm going to ask you and give my modus about why I mostly photography analog. Then I will just show you two of my projects which I'm working on right now. And then it's more, I wanted to go into a conversation, let you ask questions about your cameras or film roll or anything else. And then at the end of it, we've got an assignment for you. You each get a roll of film to develop the upcoming 3 weeks. First start with myself. I think I started around 2009 with photography. I was in 2008, I bought this crappy Canon 1000D, just a regular DSLR, but I didn't do anything with it. I just, it basically left on the shelf and I didn't do anything with it. Until basically I got an internship with my previous education. I was doing interaction design. Something completely different, but I thought while I was creative, I should have a camera. And the camera was sitting on the shelf for like a year or something. And then I started just, I met a co-worker there, and he was just all over photography, and he just didn't do anything else. He loved analog also. And he got me a bit into it by basically just starting a 350, just a year photo challenge. And I did do that, and what I got was just some pretty simple results, just nothing really that spectacular. But then I started to find out something that I really loved. Just a bit more like the abandoned buildings, like the fall.
Decay,
yes, thank you. The decay in urban environments, basically just buildings, and then I started exploring maybe just the urban exploration scene, and maybe some of you heard about it, I guess so, to be honest, this is one of my few HDR pictures I have made. I'll get back to that later, to Adia. But I didn't really like that, and basically just the whole culture of it. It wasn't really my thing, but I just loved just exploring abandoned buildings. I kept on going further and further into Belgium and Germany, just visiting lovely castles and large industry terrains. Photography was mostly fun, but it was also pretty dangerous for me at some point. It was the most fun of it was to go on top of a really dangerous building, which is pretty life-threatening sometimes. And basically just exploring mostly the abandoned buildings in Eindhoven, which were going to be demolished. Maybe you know this building?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, it's... what was it? Nee, dat is de andere inderdaad. Kijk, dit was het oude Philipsgebouw.
Ja, het was een beetje...
Dat niet helemaal goed opgeblazen was, met die liftgracht.
De Bosdijk.
Bosdijk, sorry. Ja, dat was hem. Just going on top of it, which, but then photography was mostly fun, and then slowly but steady, I started going into analog photography because he had this really nice cameras and they just made a lot of great pictures, and I bought one too. And this was basically my first picture. I thought, wow, yeah, this is really cool. I think it's just 11 or something, but yeah. It just suited my my style a bit better, I guess. And then I've been at 2 years ago, I went to art school in Andrea, in which I really needed to change my view about photography, since it was mostly just about fun, and now it was like making a living out of it. Why did I start with analog photography? I first want to ask you, why do you want to try analog photography? What are the things that you say about this is why analog is better, or this is why I'm interested in it? Not everyone.
When I started photography, digital photography didn't even exist yet.
That's a good one.
And I still like to do sometimes the old style analog photography.
But it's basically the style you're shooting in, just like you need to think more about a picture, or is it just the picture itself?
No, you have to think more, and black and white is something else, something different than color photography. So
yeah.
It's quite a different thing. And sometimes I like to do that for fun.
For
me, it's a bit of curiosity. When I was young, I had the point-and-shoot camera that was analog, and I started seriously photography with digital camera, so I didn't really know much about analog. So I'm curious about the difference, because I hear a lot of people saying quality is better and it's better. So just want to try it by myself.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And I want to learn to take more time for a picture instead of just shooting whatever you see. And that's one thing that I do a lot. That I come home after a day and have 800 pictures. And that's why I think this is a nice thing to learn and to watch the world a little bit more slowly.
Yeah, for me it's also a bit back to basic. The Hasselblad, or the middle format camera, there's nothing electronic about it except for the light mirror. And you have to do everything, like the diaphragm, the exposure, all that stuff, and manually focus, and it's black and white also, like the black and white pictures. And kind of loneliness in the pictures,
a
bit dark.
I mainly use it for street photography, and people react more friendly if they see you using an analog camera.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah, it's less intimidating than a large digital.
People are even curious about it. What's that? You know. And normally, if you come with a big black DSLR, they're intimidated by it.
Yeah, they're pretty fine indeed. Yeah.
Can just use a Fuji X100.
Yeah, but then again, there's also an elegance about analog photography. You see your scene, you see the person, you see the right light, and then, all right, in the time that you approach the person, you set your camera ready, the right focus, you know, because you can estimate the distance. You just put the setting in advance, and when you're in positions. It's like you wait till the person looks at you, and then it's click, it's done. And I think with digital photography, it's like put it on burst and then burst away till you hope that there's one picture that he looks at you. So I think it's more elegant.
Yeah, and it's just the overwhelming thought of having 20 pictures of a scene. You can't really pick a white one, I guess.
Exactly.
Yeah. I'm just going to tell you some things about mainly the differences in analog photography and digital, because there's just a lot of discussion about the whole team. Is analog better or is it not, and what is better and what's not better. And I'm just going to start with my first camera. I think I wanted to put this slide somewhere else, but. Let's not do that then. Sensor size. We all have digital cameras. We have this really small camera in our phone, and most digital cameras do have this small sensor. and we have this large picture of it, which is the most common sensor sizes. For Canon, Sigma, and a 4/3 system, which basically are just all cameras which you can buy at at most camera stores, and then you get analog photography. That's basically a lot larger. As you can see in the following, there's 35 millimeter as the full frame. That's basically just your standard roll of film. That's just this frame basically. Yeah, 35 millimeters from there to there. And it's mostly bigger than most of the digital cameras. You have the Canon 5D and just some of Nikon's cameras, also full frame. I'm not that familiar with Nikon, to be honest, but they're quite expensive. Pretty expensive cameras. But on analog photography, you can get a lot more image with a lot less expense. You basically have just a 35 millimeter camera just displayed to your left. I don't have a 6x45 camera, to be honest, but I do have some 6x6 cameras. They're basically just a lot larger already. And the frame is, like it said, it's 6x6 centimeters. To be precise, it's like 56x56 millimeters, I guess. And you have different rolls of film for it too. I didn't think I bring one with me, but there is one in the Hasselblad over there. you get basically 6x7. And that's slightly larger, as you can see, but it's still the same roll of film. And then you have this 4x5 inch cameras. They're basically really, really old cameras. They're still being made today, but the principle is, I think, from 1930 or 1920. And that's this one. It's a huge as this device. It's not really handy to take with you, but it takes beautiful pictures. Yeah, it's old, so it's not always. You basically have this whole backside as as a large viewfinder, in which if you take a picture, you make a negative the size of this, which is approximately 50 times bigger than the 35 millimeters. But what basically means you have 50 times more information on your picture, which I generally just stole off from Wikipedia. Many professional quality film cameras use medium format or large format films. Basically, medium format is just the 6x45, 6x6, 6x7, and you basically have some other formats since it was just a long sheet of film. You even have 6x9 or 6x80 for really large panoramas. For medium format or large format films, that's 4x5, but you even have cameras that are even bigger, like 8x10, 8x10 inches, or 10x22 inches. But they're this size negative you have. So imagine how big your camera would be. Because of the size of the imaging area, they can record higher resolution images than current top-of-the-range digital cameras. A medium format image can record an equivalent potential of approximately 400 megapixels, while large format films can record considerably larger, 4x5 inch, which equals to 800 megapixels on the largest common film format. Yeah, 400 and 800 megapixels sounds like way too much, which of course it is. And you need some really expensive scanners to get that resolution. personally, I get, I think I get about 50 megapixels from shooting my 6x6. And 150, 180 approximately, it also depends on what scanner I use, when I shoot 4x5 inch, which is of course a lot of information, and you get a lot more to work with basically. Is this clear? Yes. I'm not really sure if I'm just talking gibberish. So. Where is my? Yeah. This is basically just the focal length and which actual focal length you use on what camera. Basically. Let's just start by saying we have just a regular 50 millimeter lens. If you get this 6x6 field of view camera, you get 32 millimeters of view, which accounts that if you have a 50 millimeter lens on this one, you get a wide angle view. If you push it even better by 4x5, doesn't really have it, no. The 37 millimeters on 4x5, that's a ultra large wide angle, which means 14 millimeters. Because basically, by the more size you need to use, by the more you want to expose, the larger aperture you need. Which basically also accounts in larger apertures and smaller
depth of field.
Smaller depth of field and larger apertures. Just basic basic cameras with medium format cameras. They don't really have lenses that are faster than 2.8. Yes, yeah, you can get some, but it's not common. And there is one 4x5 inch lens, which is 2.8, but that's extremely rare. And most commonly, this one is basically, let's see, 4.7. And my other one is close at 8. I didn't bring that one. But it's a wide angle lens, and you get aperture 8, which means you really need to increase your exposure times, making it even tougher or longer to produce an image.
Can you please explain this part in Dutch for me?
Heb ik dat gisteren niet al gedaan?
Gisteren was ik heel moe.
Nee, het komt eigenlijk een beetje op neer dat als je een normale 50 mm lens hebt en je zou die op deze camera zetten, dus een groter formaat, dat je dan, even kijken, dan ga je bij de 6x6, 50, dan heb je dus een beeldhoek van 32 mm. Mm-hmm. Dus dan heb je een redelijk grote hoek. Maar stel je voor, je zou diezelfde lens, of je zou een lens hebben die op je 4x5-inch camera zou passen, dan zou je, ja, dan kijk ik even, dus pak ook gewoon de verkeerde steden weer. Maar dan moet je dus bij de 4x5-inch kijken en dan heb je een beeldhoek van 14, 15 mm. Dus dat is een heel, heel erg groot hoek. Het wil eigenlijk op neer dat hoe groter je formaat is, des te meer licht je eigenlijk nodig hebt qua brandpuntsafstand, waardoor je even kijken, waardoor je de scherptediepte wordt dan ook moeilijker, ja, kleiner, en je diafragma's worden groter. Dus wat ik net zei is dat deze
hoge getallen,
ja, sorry, ja, hoge getallen. Ik zeg dat ook altijd goed een keer.
Als je zeg maar hier, als dit je gevoelige plaat is, zeg maar, en dit is je lens. En je hebt hier door die lens kan bijvoorbeeld maar zo'n hoek uitkomen qua licht, zeg maar. Dat is de maximale hoek die eruit kan komen. Stel je zet er een plaatje achter wat zo groot is, dan kun je dus ook maar zo'n klein gedeelte van het licht opvangen. Als je een hele grote plaat achter zet, dan vang je een veel grotere hoek, zeg maar, op. En dat is daarom hoef je hem ook maar hoef je niet zo zeg maar
de brandpunt
moeilijk,
ja.
toch?
Ja, ja,
dat is als je op een brandpunt ligt je in een grote vlak.
Ja, want zeg maar op een 35 mm camera moet je heel moeilijk doen met allemaal hele ingewikkelde lenzen die van alle hoeken zeg maar licht binnen kan komen om dat maar op dat hele kleine plaatje terecht te krijgen zeg maar.
Ja.
Terwijl bij zo'n grotere plaat dan heb je met een 80 mm heb je dan inderdaad wel 50 mm.
Ja, precies. Ja.
Dus, ja.
Ja.
Dus is het dan moeilijker? Is het more difficult with those bigger plates to have a telescope?
To have a zoom. Yeah, you have just this larger lenses with larger focal lengths. I mean, basically this one is 127, and that's basically just a regular 15 millimeter sort of. On a just on a large camera, and it's tougher basically because you have just less depth of field and less light coming in. If you have more, but it's less accounted for the part you need to exposure because the size is bigger basically.
Yeah, because the depth the aperture is a number that's related to the size of the.
Of the sensor. Indeed, yeah.
And so if your sensor is huge, it's very hard to get a big
aperture.
Big aperture.
Indeed, yeah. That's.
And then you have to spend so much money to get it.
Get
a big aperture that it's not worth it.
No, indeed. No, I could have.
You would have to have like this big of a lens to be able to get an aperture of 1.8 or so.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah, but if you reverse it, you can use this huge telephoto telezoom lenses. You can put them on your DSLRs with just smaller apertures, and you get huge zoom lenses. You can reverse it also.
Yeah. Question: on all the lenses, they're just the actual lens focal length numbers on it.
Sorry.
Because if you have an APS-C sensor, and there are also lenses that only work with the APS-C sensor and not with the full frame, are the numbers on the lens the same?
With the APS-C, they put a number on it which is related to the 35 millimeter, but actually it's not, of course.
Okay.
And with these things, because only experts use that. Stuff they actually put the actual lens focal length on it, and that's also because of history behind it. But if you buy such a crop sensor, then and you put a lens on it, it will say 50 millimeter. But in fact, is 80 millimeter.
Yeah.
85.
Yeah, I have this 17 to 40 millimeter lens right here, and I use it just on this analog camera, but I use it also on my DSLR. Basically, on this this one, it's a pretty big wide angle at 17, and it's at 40, it's still pretty wide. But when I place this on my APS-C, my DSLR, which has just a 1.6 crop sensor, it is basically just almost a normal focal range, like 24-70, which used to be the standard in. In analog cameras, which has 35 millimeters, but they usually sell what you get if you buy just a DSLR, you get this 17-55 kit lens, and if you calculate that back to 35 millimeters, it's 24-70 sort of. Mm-hmm. So if you can put that one on a full frame camera, which most of them can't, because they're just a bit more back, and if you do, you will break your mirror. So it's not that a great idea. You can you get this huge as wide angle.
Yeah, it's almost impossible to fit an 80 millimeter on such a thing, because if you see there 35 millimeter, I think that's almost like 10 or so.
Yeah.
In I don't know exactly the calculation.
Yeah, it's super also wide. If you have this smaller these lenses for smaller formats, you can't put them on this giant 4x5 inch cameras because they don't have the angle of view in there.
Oh, you get a black, you get a circle.
Okay. Yeah, you get a small circle and it turns black at the end. Yeah. Next up is pretty much grain, which is also a pretty hot topic when it comes to analog photography, since they say the grain is unmatchable and you can't reproduce it in Photoshop. But yeah, actually you can. There are I looked it up on the internet a couple of weeks ago, but you can just get these texture packs, which are literally just scan negatives with the grain. Just only negative with grain, so you can reproduce it, but it's still a lot different. Just a basic ISO question. I think this is pretty familiar, I guess, right? In film, you also have these. You have this setback. You have with a roll of film, you have just one sort of ISO. It's what used to be called ASA or DIN back in the days, but that's just a different form of measuring. It's, you can just basically get every roll as an ISO weighting on it. And you can't really change it, just a standard film speed. The grain, there is a grain in analog photography. Instead of in digital photography, you have noise. As you can see here, there are two pictures. They're not mine, but just stole them off the internet. And which of you think is the analog one?
Right one.
Also the left one.
I think the left one. Yeah.
I think also the left one.
It is the left one. the white one has more of this image noise. Yeah, you can't really see it. Maybe on the computer you can see the difference better. Yeah. But in the white one you have more color noise. And in the left one you get this more. It's hard to explain basically, but it's more like this subtle, more natural, grainy substance, I guess. Let's see, another basic comparison here. It's also this one's analog and this one's digital. Yeah. It doesn't really show that good word in the beamer, to be honest. But it are just basic, really subtle differences. And in low ISO films, you rarely see any grain. But lots of photographers, especially with street photographers, they tend to use a little bit higher ISO weightings. You get this lovely grain. This is basically an example of it.
Is it below there is more detailed than?
I think below has met, especially on those on the roof.
Yeah.
You can see like strange dots. In the top one, and the down one doesn't really have that.
Yeah,
it's just
it's digital. It's a bit cleaner, I guess. It's basically really standard. Personally, I think it's just you take a picture and you know what kind of colors of graduations you get. But in analog photography, you get this much finer grainy substance, which gives a bit more texture, I think, to your photo. Like shown here, just some of my grainier pictures. I guess this is this was all weighted at the ISO 800. It's not really good to show on the beam.
Turn it down on the left.
This one wasn't my best grainy picture, so this one made me better.
Yeah.
This is some black and white. You can, it's it shows a bit more better. Also a street, something I did on the street, I think a couple of months ago in Brussels. But I just recently discovered the phone. I was like, oh, cool. I forgot about it. Yeah, that basically was great. Dynamic range, that's maybe a tougher subject. Do you know what dynamic range is? I can do this whole lot of technical story, but maybe it's better.
What's in Dutch?
Dynamisch bereik.
Oh, I know that.
Yep. basically it's just the difference between pure is white and black is black. Mostly in which was mostly used by this guy. Maybe you know him.
Ansel Adams.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah. He designed this the zone system, which basically accounts for 10 shades of gray, in which he made all his pictures, which is gigantic exposure charge, which I'm not going to go depth in. But if you want, I can tell about it later. It's pretty amazing how this guy did it. But thing with film is that it doesn't maybe has this much more dynamic range. In case of digital cameras are getting way and way better at it, in just making differences between just a purest white and a purest black. Film can be much more forgiving than digital photography. In this example shows, this is just a photo which has here been exposed correctly, just normal exposure, and then one stop, two stops, three stops, and four stops overexposure, which you can generally see on the negative, but with scanning and or in the darkroom, you can just brush all those differences just away. Like you can see, it's most of the people who use analog photography, they shoot portraits, they tend to overexpose them a bit just to make it a bit more dreamy. Like you say, it's maybe a plus two, plus three. It also depends on the kind of film you use. But basically, it's a high dynamic range picture in one picture. You didn't have high dynamic range in the analog era. But you have it now, since the digital cameras weren't quite up to it when they started it. But lately they have been catching up. But it's still not that forgiving. You can't just do a plus four exposure like this and not get any black and dark whites. Basically just some false examples, two examples of mine. This one is just a digital one of mine with my 7D and this lens. And this one is just made analog on this one. As you can see the windows here, it was purest white in photo. You got to believe me. And here you have this more this detail in it.
You mean the structure and the glass?
Yeah. Like it's here you can't see really any hostile.
It's blown out.
It's blown out indeed. Yeah, in which here you can see all the broken windows and same here. It's like this one is a bit like blue, and this one is just blown out white. And you can see a lot less. Yeah, it's also the beamer, but there is some shadow detail, but it's less. Customizable and digital.
And what is the technique that you explained? How do you get this?
It's not a technique. It's just basically how analog is being shot. It's basically just the same picture I took, which is with that camera and with a digital one. But because film has different ways of handling with the purest white and the purest black, you can get this just by basically shooting it, you don't overexpose the highlights that easy.
Okay. I always say that the analog has more information in the highlights, especially like the whites. There's a lot of difference between white and a little bit less white.
Yeah.
And with a digital camera, you don't see that anymore. It just registers white, and that's it.
Yeah.
It just cuts it off. And with analog, it's automatically that it has more information in it.
That is the higher dynamic range.
Yeah.
More stops between black and white.
Yeah. Especially in that higher range.
More levels visible.
Yes, and last of all, it's just a completely different way of taking pictures. Before I started, basically, I do pretty much all analog now. But you don't have a second tap, or you take another picture, of course. But you just get your camera and you just think twice to yourself. Like you put it on your tripod or you place it there and you I now have like 10 frames or that much frames left, and I just want to make something good. You don't want to do everything in Photoshop. It's like, it's not really that straight, or I'll get that out. Or you don't want to do that in our photography. Like I said, you have this different limited number of frames. With this 35 millimeters rolls, you get 24 or 36 pictures on it. You have this on medium format, which I didn't want along with me. You have these, it depends on what format you're using, but basically, it's just one roll of film, which I think it's about this long. And if you shoot it with 6x6 pictures, you get 12 shots. If you do 6x7, you get 10 of it, because basically the picture gets bigger. It's not really a grid on it. And by 6x4.5, it makes 18 pictures. And with this big one, you have these holders, which I also forgot. you have these large film holders, which you can go one frame at each side. You have this front end and you have a back end, and you can just switch them, and you have this huge cartridge, which is pretty unhandy, and you have just two of them basically fitting in there. I think I'm going to bring them along next week or next time. And indeed, last point, people look and interact at you different. I've been on the streets a lot with some analog cameras, but some people just don't care, especially if you're just with that huge ass thing. Like, some people just come to you and like, that's a cool camera. What are you taking pictures of? And it's a lot less intimidating. You don't get really much noticed, and even if you get this, this is pretty much just some sort of camera they use. They use for street photography. You can just basically just click and you're gone. You can be really subtle, or you can just place it all out and then just take your time, and then people won't notice you anymore. They just think, okay. I'm going to tell you a bit about what I do with analog photography. I'm in third year of art school now, and basically I think for the last year and a half, I've been doing some series in a village called Borchemie. It's just across the border in Germany, and it's a village which is going to be destroyed in, I think, 2 years. I'm just going to sneak peek. Yeah, 2 years. Yeah. And it's being destroyed because the ground owner of it has brown coal, which has been used to generate electricity. But like a sneak peek, it's this gigantic huge hole. It's insane. You can't really believe it how big this is.
It was a whole village.
You have this Borchemie. It stands just right here. I've been to Pech last when I started. but that's all gone. And you basically have the Tagebau Grachtweiler to the right, and this area marks just how much they're going to use for brown coal, and yeah, how many villages are still going down. Let's see, yeah. To give you an impression of the hole, this is at the side of it. It's also made with this camera. Fun fact, maybe. And the hole is, I think, 35 kilometers in width. And it's accounted for, they mine brown coal at 250 meters deep, and they go all the way to 300 meters. So basically, yeah, this wasn't the deepest part, but you can just look a lot further, and yeah, they're basically in it, and just, it's again, it's insane. And what I've been doing there, last year I did this article about Borsemich, that does exist in over 4 years, which was also some kind of disappointment, because I shot everything analog, of course, 6x6, and they generally just drop my pictures.
No.
Yeah, it's really sad. It's like, ah. It was my first article I published just last year, and I was like, yeah, and this got really no. And then yeah, I've been there for like a year or something, and it's really overwhelming, I guess. You just have the streets and just this whole village, which was made in, I think, yeah, which has been there for hundreds and hundreds of years, even have some new buildings, and yeah, just your regular village, I guess, but instead of here, nobody lives there. It's really a dance. I also tend to go in these abandoned places, of course, or in these abandoned buildings, which isn't really supposed to be happening there, because there's lots and lots of security, especially lately. But and I tend to just shoot the things I love about it, or the things that intrigues me, just like especially those curtains or just those ugly wallpapers, and especially then with analog, you see it's just not that white and not that black. It's really, it just makes us really much more subtle. And lately I've been doing something with windows, because in our school we are pretty much used to more conceptual part of the photography, wherein you tend to have this you basically start from a question or some point of interest, like what my starting point was, right? Why and how did this is can this happen? Just a gigantic hole, and just some company that destroys like 20-30 villages, and that's not accounting for all the nature, forest, everything they're going to destroy. And one of the really things that noticed me was just the windows, because all the houses were completely littered, and all the copper was being stolen. And basically, the thing that people left in there were the curtains. That's just the everything was empty except for some curtains and windows. So that's basically my where I'm busy with now. It's not finished. I'm still going there. Still going to find out as many windows as possible, but. I have this deadline for upcoming May to have an exhibition in Gelderop, just a village outside of here, and that's my deadline, so I need to make a good series of it. And also something else, maybe, it's also where could be interesting, around my window, sorry. And it's a series which I'm calling Faded Landscapes. Also in the village there was this basement which wasn't really plundered, but it was still, nobody really had been there. It was scattered with deers
Yeah, I think so. Tires? Yeah, I'm not sure.
Yes.
Slides, maybe.
Slides?
No, no.
Yeah. Yeah, bring up all the
digital. Some slides?
Slides?
Yeah,
slide film. Yeah,
yeah, I need slide film. Yeah. Yeah, which were just scattered across the place, and they were, they were in horrendous shape. They were, half of them wasn't even, when you picked it up, literally fell out of each other. And I took this, I was like 2 hours busy or something, just grabbing everything I can, like, oh, this could be something. And then I started scanning this film in, and I was like, this is nothing. But basically, this is not really an image on this anymore, but it makes a new kind of image, I guess. Basically, why I want to use it, also a series still in progress, but because of the title Faded Landscapes, I want to use in context of the village, which relates to the memories of those people which used to be there on these pictures, but I know completely faded away just for this gigantic hole, just for some energy. And this was one which was a bit better. You could see there's not that much in it. Most colors are of it are gone. Also some, I'm not really sure what this is, but sort of sand or something, yeah.
Mold.
Yeah, maybe mold in it, yeah. I'm not quite sure, but it's really, yeah, but by basically just scanning them in, you get this really lovely, just this a sort of overlay of these images. Because the negative has been destroyed, I guess. It's broken the film layer. And it sort of creates a new image, and I really like this fact, and I'm still continuing scanning, but I'm going to make just a series, which has this which I'm trying to get to relate to the memories that has all been lost there. Yeah. And just another one, which you can see better the extra layer of molds where. Basically this is most of my presentation. I do have some slides furthermore, just about difference in film walls and basically slight color changes. But from this point on, I want to ask if there's anything you would like to know, or some tips, or basically, yeah. Yeah.
Where did you get that big camera from?
This one.
Yeah.
I bought it on Marktplaats.
Okay.
But I was pretty much searching for a large format camera, but those things are huge. You have this huge S-size box which they come in, and they launch tripods on it, and they're still being made. You have these beautiful wooden cameras.
Yeah.
Also, but if you let them fall one time, they just break apart, and you, it's done. But this one is a speed graphic. I think it's from the 20s, 1930s. If you can remember some really old films, just movies, you know, they have these really big press cameras, which is large lightning bulbs on it.
Yeah.
That's this camera.
Exactly. Yeah, I've been searching for a large format camera, but I'm not sure if I'm supposed to buy it now, because I don't take that many pictures, and second of all, I don't know what I should buy, because it's very difficult to find out what is, because the only way to buy it is on the internet, so you just
have to
make a guess or so.
Yeah, you have some companies who just make. Which make their own cameras, which is something I really want to do myself, to make an 8x10 inch camera, because basically just this technical camera is nothing more than a lens and a light proof bulb.
I don't know what it means.
No, a bellow. You want a bellow?
Bellow,
yeah. But basically, yeah, it's just a box.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
So you can buy them in all kinds of shapes, but they're pretty hard to find. But yeah, this one is one of the cheaper versions, I guess. I think I bought it for 250 euros. Mm-hmm. And the whole thing of this camera is that it has eventually has a huge shadow in it, in the back. But yeah, mine isn't really working. Yeah. Still trying to fix that sometimes, because if you get this shutter fixed, you can even buy just enlarger lenses, which are pretty good, and other lenses which normally you need a shutter for. That's a shutter based built in this lens. Let's see. Basically get this shutter and just two pieces of glass.
Do you also have that cable? Do you also have that, or how do you?
Oh yes, a long cable. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, you can. There was just this. There was this mechanism where you can just make a picture by pressing this button, but that's broken too, and it's also really lens dependent. But you have this large, remote shutter, I guess. You'll use it for other cameras too.
Yo, tengo Calderón, Don Omar, los bandoleros. Con mi tumba.